My name is Dirk Geveling. I'm a machine learning engineer at Godaze Riven, and Molly has hired us to help them with the cloud transformation.
So, Molly, how many people here have heard of Molly? Can I see some hands? Okay, that's like every year we ask that, it's getting better. A lot of people seeing that on, for example, the statements, the bank statements. Okay, so what is Molly? Molly is founded in 2004 already. Originally, actually an SMS company, but switched to iDEAL Payments, local Dutch payment method. And growing slowly in the beginning, but then trying to become an aggregator of payment methods. So we are a payment service provider. And trying to help businesses grow by giving them a way to receive payments online. So we do, for example, over 60% of the Netherlands of Dutch web shops are connected via Molly. And now, recently scaling up the business. So you can see over 150 people, 150 faces now, mostly in the last 2 years. So what we do is, in the last year, we did 65 million payments, more than 65 million payments, for over 120,000 merchants, with over 6 billion of third-party revenue, so money flowing through the system. And currently, we have offices in the Netherlands, Belgium, Germany, France, and this is really where we are focusing outside of the Netherlands. Like I said, Netherlands, we are already a big player, but now, and in Belgium already too, really focusing on Germany right now. It's going to be interesting. So we focus on global and local payments. We really want to make it easy for small, medium companies to start getting payments, and we really focus on those localized payment methods. So iDEAL in the Netherlands, for example, but EPS and GiroPay in Germany, Bancontact in Belgium, many different localized payment methods.
And of course, these payments, they generate a lot of data. And according to Forrester, almost 60 to 73% of all the data within an enterprise is simply not used. But if you want to become a data-driven company, you have to use this data, well, more often and also a lot smarter. So what type of data do we have at Molly? So we have marketing data, we have CRM data, and of course, we also have a lot of payments data. But this data at Molly tends to be very, very complex, because Molly supports so many different payment methods, and all these payment methods are handled in a different way, which also results for basically different data. So on top of this complex data, we also have a lot of PII data and a lot of finance data. And that basically means that we have to handle this data very, very carefully, and this makes for a very complex data ecosystem. So way back in 2018, we worked as follows. So basically, whenever an analyst wanted to do a certain analysis, he would go to compliance. He would ask, "Can I maybe get access to this piece of data on this database?" He would get access, and then he would create a one-off query and do whatever analysis he needed to do using its own tools, basically. But this meant that whenever you have one-off queries, it kind of becomes hard when you do year-to-year reporting, right? Because often these reports will change from year to year, but also the interpretation of the data changes. Well, this is and when you combine this with not having the data in a central location, this makes for a system that doesn't work that well.
So looking at this data maturity model, you can see different levels from chaos to optimized, like data-driven organization. And I can say that Molly was really in the chaos position. We tried to standardize some things or hand over some queries from one person to the other, but that was really not the way of working, of course. So we needed to set standards for data, for reporting, centralized stuff, to make sure that we go from chaos to really a data-driven strategy. We really wanted to transform the organization to a data-driven organization, and that cannot be without management buy-in, without having the organization making a turn for this and to understand how important it is to become data-driven. So I can't say we are, like, after 1 year, we're all the way to optimized, but we're certainly in this process of alignment, setting standards, and getting things right. So what now? What needed to happen for that? Basically, like Diederik already said, we needed to centralize this data to be able to do these analysis and these things. So what were we set out to build was a data lake. And a data lake to centralize our data to do things like reporting, visualization, advanced analytics, and stuff like machine learning, which we really didn't use yet. So, hey, we don't have kind of a real data infrastructure, so we don't have any legacy. That's great, right? You can just, hey, we can go ahead, start building this thing. But on the other hand, no legacy sounds great, but we didn't really have the people in-house to set this up. So it was kind of a daunting task, like, okay, wait, what do we do next? Well, for starters, let's build a data team. And so we had to get the right people in. Data engineers, data scientists, analysts, the people that know how to build this infrastructure, because, well, that's what you start off with, right? You need the proper infrastructure for the people to work with.
So the question is, how do we actually build a data lake? So what we did, Molly has multiple data sources, so often multiple databases, and we are actually ingesting this data from all these databases into one central location. And on top of that, you want to actually connect tools to that. So for example, that your data scientist and also analyst can actually use this data which is stored in a central place. So for that, at Molly, we actually using the Google Cloud. So the Google Cloud already has a lot of data tools which we can use, but it also gives us some other pros. So for example, whenever you want to build this on an on-premise system, well, that's a lot harder. You have a lot less flexibility, but also you need to maintain a whole team to maintain this infrastructure for you. With the Google Cloud, we can scale this very, very easily, and we can just ingest all of our data and store it in one central place without having to worry about scaling issues. So what type of tools do we use for that? So we basically see, well, for the day-to-day flow, for the analysts and the data scientists, they mainly use BigQuery and also Jupyter Notebooks. So they get their own Jupyter environment, which is basically just Python, and that will be connected to the data lake. So they can reach any data that they basically want. Also, we are using a lot of Spark basically for building our data pipelines and for handling our big data part, and we are using Airflow that basically orchestrates whatever data pipeline we are building. So Airflow tells you, for example, that this data pipeline has to run every day at 12 o'clock, and then Airflow makes sure that this actually happens. Of course, we also store our data in the cloud. So we do that on Google Cloud storage buckets, and of course also in BigQuery. But we will come to that. But most of these tools are actually managed services by Google. So you have, for example, Airflow that is Composer, and you have Spark that is Databook. I see a question. Yeah. Sorry, so this is all run on the Google Cloud, and these are all managed services by the Google Cloud. So Airflow, that's Composer, Spark, that is just that, and it runs on our Hadoop cluster, so that is Dataproc, and Dataproc also supports your Jupyter notebook environments. So this is all being run on the Google Cloud, but that will become more clear maybe later in the process. Okay. So what we are mainly going to talk to you about this is the ingestion part. So we are going to show you how do you build these data pipelines and how do you actually ingest this data into your data lake, so basically into the Google Cloud. And for that, one of the ways we can do that is using batch processing.
Yeah, so batch processing allows you to very quickly get your data in a Google Cloud. So if you need to prove something to an organization that just starts to become data-driven, like Molly, it's good to be able to move fast. So what are the pros of batch processing? Basically, what you can do is you can take a snapshot of your source system and copy that to your data lake. That means that it's static. Your data doesn't change through the day. You basically have all your data until the moment you ingested it. And there's no need to take any schema changes into consideration. Basically, you have one data set, and your data analysts can query that without any problems. So what does that look like? What does a pipeline for batch processing look like? We start off with, well, in case of Molly, a MySQL database. And we use Dataproc, which is that managed service, Spark service, to ingest the data and to move it to a data bucket. Basically, place everything from that source system on a data bucket. Why do we do that without any transformation? Basically, if we have that data in the Google Cloud, we don't have to go back to that source system and do it again. So basically, if something fails after this process, we can basically take this raw source data and continue. So after that, we process that raw data, we cleanse it, we take out, for example, columns that we don't need or don't want, we pivot key value stores, things like this, to make it more useful, easier to query from the data warehouse. And then we store it in, again, data buckets, but basically the process data buckets, and in BigQuery. So if you might ask, why do you place it in both of these? Well, BigQuery is really handy to build, for example, dashboards on and do reporting stuff. But if you want to run your Jupyter notebooks, it's actually much cheaper to go to the file system, to the buckets, than to query BigQuery, which might run more expensive really quickly. And on top of that, we use Airflow, so Composer, to run the task that actually do the ingestion, pull it through Spark, and then get it in the buckets. So what are the downsides of this approach? Basically, you put a lot of load on the source system, because at once you basically pull out all the data from that source system. And secondly, scalability. What if that source system becomes so big that you cannot pull it out, or that pulling out the ingestion basically takes more than 24 hours, for example? Then you cannot do a daily ingestion anymore, and things start to be more difficult.
A small question.
Yeah.
Do you have nested data? Because we use BigQuery for just the principal nested data. Do you flatten it in the storage part, or are they the same format?
So generally, it is the same format. But what we are doing in this process data step. For example, we also have key value stores, and those are then pivoted, and that will create a column for example in your BigQuery table, that kind of stuff. But we don't have if you mean by nested data, actually data within data, that's not the case.
Well, if you would like to have that, for example, unnested in BigQuery, you can take care of that in that processing step. So whatever is most optimal for you to query or to use at process time.
And you were talking about structured data here.
Mm-hmm. Structured? What do you mean?
From databases, transactions.
Right.
Yeah.
You could, of course, if you don't come from a MySQL database, but you come from other systems, you can store those just in raw data buckets, of course, to have everything centralized. So imagine you have a whole bunch of images somewhere. You can use the same process to orchestrate pulling in all those images, storing them in the Google Cloud as well to be used for processing later.
So there were some cons to batch processing, mainly that you have and that you run into scalability problems. So enter streaming. So with streaming, we don't process our data anymore per batch, but we process it per event, meaning that whenever a change happens on our MySQL database, that change will be streamed directly into our data lakes. For example, an update to a row, we will receive that immediately. And then we can also process that immediately, and that will result that we don't have a heavy load at a certain point in time on our database, just continuously over the whole day. Well, we have multiple, streaming of course has multiple pros. So one is one is the fact that we don't do any batch processing anymore. The other one is that of course we process everything in near real time, meaning that whenever a change happens on our MySQL database, it will arrive on our data lake within milliseconds. And this is actually kind of really cool, right? Because as a data scientist, you're then working with live data, which also supplies you with a lot of new use cases, right? So for example, if you want to predict churn, so whenever a customer is maybe going to stop being a customer, you can do an analysis on this and send a live signal to your support team or to your sales team, like okay this customer is probably going to churn, please and please contact him. So that's all very, very useful information to get as fast as possible. And of course you don't need any orchestration anymore. So you don't need any airflow anymore because this is just a continuous data stream. So you never have a process that and it says, okay, please start at 12 o'clock at night. No, this is just a continuous process. So what does a streaming pipeline actually look like? So again, we have our MySQL database. From this database, we use a tool called Maxwell's Daemon, which actually looks at the bin log. And the bin log is just one big file on your database that tracks every change. So every update, every delete, every create, whatever, that's all in your bin log. And Maxwell's Daemon reads that bin log and then creates a JSON message out of this. So it basically creates a JSON event and it sends it to PubSub. And PubSub is basically a managed messaging service from Google where you can send events to. So you can send small parts of data to PubSub. And then you can pick it up anywhere else in your system. So any other tool can read from PubSub and actually read those events. So what does an event actually look like? So say you have a very simple table within your MySQL database. We have a table over here with two columns and three rows. So the event looks as follows. Whenever an insert happens, we receive an event with type of insert, row ID 1, and then the data in there. And in this case, the data is just a string, like data 1, which of course you could have multiple columns in there. So basically, every event describes one row. Now, once we have these events on PubSub, we can actually receive them using Dataflow. So Dataflow is a managed service from Google using Apache Beam, and with Apache Beam we can actually process these events in a streaming manner. So we can actually apply transforms on the fly, if you will. Meaning that whenever we receive an event on there, we can process this event, we can increase quality and whatever, and then we can stream it directly into BigQuery. Well, and that's basically a streaming pipeline.
Well, that actually looks very simple. I think we worked a long time on this, right? So what happened?
Yeah, so it turned out not to be this simple, basically. So whenever you are talking about streaming, you will notice that many people are talking about ordering. So whenever you read that bin log, you will see that that's in order. So everything is just line by line by line. So you will have, for example, every update will come after each other. But the problem is that within PubSub, you don't have any ordering. Meaning that, for example, if you have two updates to the same row, it could happen that you first receive the last update and then the first one. And this is, of course, a problem, because if you apply them in that order, you will get a different result. That's not something that you would want. So we fixed that by actually taking the timestamp that's in the bin log. And then using that timestamp, we would add it to our event and set it all the way over to BigQuery. So we exactly know within BigQuery which events arrived first before the others. And then we can just simply sort on there And then we have solved this ordering issue. I wish it was as simple as that, but I think that most of the people who work with data and who actually transferred data from one system to the and to the other one knows that it's always very, very complicated. And this is exactly what we are doing, since actually we are transferring our data from a database to a data warehouse, which is BigQuery in this case. And you will see that those systems have different properties. So for example, within a MySQL database, you can very easily apply schemas, right? So you can change schemas in there, you can delete columns, you can add columns, whatever. Also, you can very easily do updates and the deletes on your tables. However, in BigQuery, this isn't really supported because in BigQuery you can only add columns. You can't delete them and you can't change the types. Also, what we are seeing is that whenever you want to do an update and a delete on a BigQuery table, this is rather limited because you can only do 1,000 per day. Right, and we are way over that limit with Molly. So this is actually a problem. So how do we actually handle updates and the deletes? Well, luckily that's relatively easy since we already have the timestamp. And if we go back to our original example, so you have the three rows over here, and we receive three inserts with the timestamp 1, 2, and 3. So just for this demo purposes, then when you receive an update, you will get an update for the row 3 basically, and then you will see that it will have timestamp 4 in this case, and we also put the full data in there. So the full data is in there, and in this case the new data is just a string named new. So what we do then is we are grouping by the row ID, then sorting on the timestamp, and then taking the last row from that, and using that you will always get the latest row or the latest event per row ID, right? And if all the data is if all the data is encoded in that event for that row, you can simply always take the last row per row ID the last event per row ID, and then you always have the current version of your table. So the idea is to just make sure that every event includes the full data of every row, and then you can fix this relatively simple.
Well, that's not obviously only per row, but we're working hard on that Molly platform, and we add a lot of changes to the schemas. We delete columns. We change a lot of this stuff. How does this? I mean, I can imagine it breaks.
Well, it does sometimes, but not anymore. So we have a very unique position at Molly, where the data team is relatively new. Molly already had quite a lot of databases, which are managed by other teams, and they are just allowed to push schema changes and to change whatever about the database. So we didn't really want to be in between that process. So we didn't really want to be the person who said, but you can't push that schema change, because that will not work within the data lake.
Or not yet. Maybe next sprint.
No. But we wanted to fix this dynamically. So in the end, what we want to do is that whenever a schema change happens on the MySQL database, we actually also want to apply that schema within BigQuery. But we simply can't, because BigQuery doesn't allow us to do that. So the way we fix that is we're saying whenever we receive a schema change event, so whenever a schema change happens, Dataflow will pick that up. So Dataflow will see, apparently I received a schema change, so a table change, and then it will create a new table within BigQuery with that new schema. Once that is done, the next step is that Dataflow tells Maxwell's daemon, I have created a new table. Can you please send me all the data for the table again? And because this is basically a select star over your database, that and that data will have the newest schema in there. And because we are also sending the schema versions with every event, Dataflow knows in which table to place that to place all the events based on your schema version. So if you receive all the data again, that will have the newest schema, and that will be placed in the new table. And once that process is done, we can simply delete the old table, and then you have the newest version in there. So a question, yeah?
You
first, yeah. Exactly. So that is true. So once this happens, you see that you see indeed a big load on the database. But what we notice that at Molly, that schema changes, especially in the larger tables, don't happen that often, right? And it's still just a read operation. So you could create a read slave and then read from that and just use that whenever this happens.
So yeah, we have a read slave set up, so we will actually not pull the data out of the source system, out of the production system. Plus, in this case, you're not actually pulling out the entire database, it's just a single table, can be big, of course. And this doesn't happen every day. So let's say a couple times a week that can happen, but at least you're pulling in one table only.
Exactly, and especially with the larger ones, I think they only change like two times per year, so
exactly.
You're still relatively okay over there. So yeah, and you also had a question, yeah?
Yeah, that was sort of my question as well, like if it takes more time to read the table and to change the data, then you update the schema.
Yeah.
But yeah, like if the answer is you don't change the schema that often, then it's fine.
Yeah, exactly.
But then just another question, isn't this like, what way to BigQuery, you don't, if you just
No,
thinking
no,
no. About the cost, but it's basically it's for the queries and the saving.
Yeah,
later.
Exactly. Yeah. So you don't really pay for the for the storage.
Like small time period that you have two tables with an interrupt.
Yeah. Okay. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So another question? Yeah.
Yeah. Why do you call again the big load injection? Because you have already in the query, you have already this data. Why don't you call it from the query instead of calling again to the big load injection to request it?
Ah, like so. So why not just use the old table, right, to ingest it again and then compose the new one?
So actually, there's multiple reasons. For example, schema change. If you add a column, it can be filled, for example, with a default value in the source system. So imagine a default value is a Boolean true. Then you want to know that and take it into the system. We don't have that yet in BigQuery. That needs to come from the source system. Also, often what you see is that a new column is added and then data is migrated from an old column to a new column. For example, you add a new timestamp column and you want to have UTC values. You go from the old value to the new value, and we want to know that information as well. So you could start out maybe with the data that you have in BigQuery, but you still need to add the new information from the source system. And if you would do that with deltas, it would become very complex. So in this case, we chose to just get everything in one shot.
Yeah, exactly. Perfect. So this is basically our full streaming pipeline. And once we have this, we actually whatever change happens on our MySQL database over here, and the system will just pick it up dynamically. So there's almost no maintenance on that point anymore, which is often perfect. And also the nice thing is that from this point on, the analysts and the data scientists can just work with this data. They can just work with it real time, and they always have the newest version of the data, basically.
Okay, so what did we talk about today? We talked about the benefits of having those components in the cloud, not having to manage them yourself. When you start out with a new team and with the need of infrastructure, the Google Cloud was really helpful in that to get us up and running. Second, we talk about batch processing, how it's easy to get up and running with just simply copying and pasting the source data in your data warehouse, for example, daily, to bring value quickly. And lastly, we talked about streaming, how it is harder, but how it will provide your system with new capabilities and new opportunities, basically, for new use cases, having less strain on your infrastructure. So I hoped this was useful for everyone. I saw people taking pictures, so that's a good sign. Thank you for listening. So I also, of course, want to mention that we are hiring as Molly. We started off this data team just 6 months ago, so there's still a lot of work to do. So yeah, if you're interested, go to jobs.molly.com.
Cool. Guys, thank you very much. Any more questions from the audience?
Yeah.
You chose GCP to do those works, but you may also choose the other cloud vendors, I guess. What was the main motivation in choosing GCP?
Yeah, there were a couple, but let's say first and foremost, we are working on a cloud migration with our platform. So actually, the software system is going to the Google Cloud. So it was sort of logical to say, okay, let's build our data infrastructure there as well, because that will just reduce the latency and the simplicity of the system. So we already jumped through all the compliance hoops for GCP. And another reason is that Molly is really, from the beginning, a tech-driven organization with a lot of developers and that really like to be hands-on, not really like a financial organization, even though we are a financial organization. And we noticed that GCP really hits that sweet spot for engineers. It's really not that salesy-driven or that... like that whole marketing thing around it. It's really focused on engineering, and it does that really well. It gives you a lot of ways to interact, automate, but also set things up really specifically and fine-tune things the way you want. And that's really something that we were looking for. So right now, there's nothing mission critical, I would say. There are things, because we started off doing things in a batched way, most of the processes are relying off at least things happening once a day. And now we can start building on top of this streaming way. There are, of course, things that are really handy to have, like the churn detection that Diederik mentioned, and also, for example, the way we keep our marketing tools up to date, the way we keep our, for example, ad targeting up to date with data warehouse. That's, you could call that mission critical.
Do you use it for any of your frauds? So,
Fraud is something we already tackled in the past, and so we have a separate solution from, let's say, the data infrastructure that is taking care of that. I can imagine that in the future we will have more and more analysis done on that using the data that we have in the data warehouse now.
Fraud is also a good example. So now, if you look at this point, when it's on PubSub, you just have it in real time. So you can very easily just connect your fraud application to that, and then you have real time fraud detection. This getting to here gives you a lot of more possibilities and a lot of more use cases which we can work on with Molly.
In our case, we're actually even early in the process, because we can already detect fraud before the payment actually happens, and we can block the payment before it happens.
Sorry, I meant more complex fraud, like analytical type operations, rather than bad payments.
Yeah, then you would use this kind of system.
No.
simple answer.
So it's
the topic of the next talk here, which is it was great to do machine learning in BigQuery with SQL, and this is a big advantage of BigQuery, and because you use BigQuery, you don't use it.
So for us, we do of course use a BigQuery for typical analysis, but we haven't really used it for machine learning yet. Mainly because most data scientists are still going the Python route, right? Where they're saying we're just using to use sklearn, which for your data pipelines, can also work more simpler because you just have this nice flow. But yeah, BigQuery ML is an option in the future, so we can start doing that.
Yeah, I want to stress the fact that at Molly, the data team is really less than 1 year old. So we've really been setting up the infrastructure first and then showing that maturity model. There's so much to do. We first want to automate stuff, do the reporting, then the more analysis, more prediction. And then eventually, I really hope that we can start building data products that we can give to our end users to bring value to them as well.
That was a question. Do you use Google tools or do you integrate in order to basically provide the merchants with analytics on the data that you have?
So, yeah, right now I can say that all the statistics that we show to the merchants are based on Elasticsearch things. So we don't use this. I've from another company that I've spoken to, they used BigQuery actually to show statistics to their customers, but that became expensive really, really quickly. So I'm not sure where we will go.
Yeah, are you building something in-house?
So right now, I don't see. I see that Elasticsearch is actually doing its job perfectly, but who knows?
So in this case, we are actually asking Maxwell's daemon. So that's a tool, and that has a function which is called table bootstrapping, where you can send a signal to Maxwell's daemon, which say, okay, please get me that whole table again, and then it doesn't read from the bin log anymore. It just does a select star on the table on the MySQL database.
Okay.
Right, so that's being retrieved, and then they are converting it to JSON, and per row they are sending events. Yeah,
okay.
Exactly. And that's also why I don't need to modify anything on this side, because it's always in the same format. Yeah.
Okay, final question.